As I said earlier, 455 partnerships now in the program, and every partnership has a different story, a different, the business leaders learn different things, the principals learn different things. But recently we had one of the business leaders from Nedbank. Nedbank is a big supporter of the program. Business leaders from Nedbank speak, and he said, similar to what was challenging us, he says, I've been going to business schools, and it's really nice, and it's fun, and you know, I get to spend time with very important people, and I'm learning about all this kind of stuff around. We were specifically talking about digitalization and the fourth industrial revolution, and he says, you know, that's fine, and that's why people go to all these business schools and to INSEAD and Harvard. But he says, what I've discovered is when I go into the school, in, and he works in a school in Soweto, it happened to be the school where he graduated as a matriculant. When I go to that school, I'm learning more about leading in the VUCA world, in the world of volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, than I could ever learn from going to INSEAD and Harvard. So Nedbank has actually changed their whole practice about leadership development, because they're realizing that leaders in Nedbank, in order for Nedbank to become the most admired bank, which is their vision, their leaders need to be in the community in Soweto, not in business school classrooms in, you know, wherever we want to go. So that's quite an exciting idea that we're going to see now many more Nedbank people. We've already got 35 Nedbank people involved already, but we will see more because Nedbank as a bank is saying that we're not going to become the most admired bank by sending our leaders to business schools. We're going to become the most admired bank by sending our leaders into schools such as Mary Kine. We want to hand over to Sabelo now, who's run out to find out where the squire has gone. But I want to just introduce you to this partnership you're going to hear from now. And they've got double the allocated time. All the other partnerships got 10 minutes. They get 20. Have we been good with keeping time? We've been very firm on keeping time. So they get 20 because we're going to hear from four different aspects of this partnership. So it's one of the partnerships that's been running for 3.5 years, I think, or maybe three. Irinay will tell his story later, but he came our way because he had a big highfalutin dream to fix education all by himself. Luckily, he spoke with someone, and this guy said, why don't you go and have a conversation with Luis van Rijn? This might be a match made in heaven. You can join forces. So 3.5 years ago, Irinay showed up, and he and Irin and Sabelo started to work together. And the story has just been amazing for all of us. And you're going to hear tonight from Sabelo, the principal, if we can just get him back into the room. We're going to hear from Irinay, who's his partner. We're going to hear from Alan Mayer, who is the district official, the really uber important person in that part of South Africa, Western Cape Education Department. No, not uber, just very, I don't know. But he's higher than most of us. So Alan is going to say something about the perspective of the Western Cape Education Department watching this from the side, because initially they wasn't so happy that this was a good idea. But now, 3 years later, they have a different perspective. And we're going to hear from a group of ladies who've been involved in the school, who've been doing some very interesting work there. So I think I'm going to hand over to you, Irinay, and you can, maybe you want to hand over to the, I don't know, you decide.
Typically, when we arrange things, they don't always go as per plan. And that was one of the first learnings I had when I started dealing with Sabelo. I was kind of like firing mails away and phone calls, and I wasn't getting much response. I was immediately getting irritable. And I finally got into a car and went there and found out that the whole school was running on one dongle, three computers in different rooms. They had to print an email here to run there. And I was getting a little bit anxious because he wasn't responding to my mail. So he's currently trying to get 60 kids from Dunoon community here to sing a song. And there aren't 60 parents with nice SUVs driving here tonight. So it's a little bit more complicated than if another school would be. But yes, we have four people up, so Sabelo's going to start with his side of our story, and then we're going to hand over to the ladies from the Books and Beyond program, and then we'll have Ellen, and then I'll wrap up for us. So over to you.
To everyone. The journey started in 2013. to my school. At that time, the school was in a mobile classes at the back of the school. It was 36 classrooms, 41 teachers, from grade R to grade 7, 1,500 learners. We turned away a lot of children. Every year we turn, as from 2013, we've been turning away as from 300 learners, from 300 and more, as from 2013. We had the list handwritten, and then RNA had a copy of that list, which landed in wrong hands in 2015, which caused a big problem. But as we speak today, we've got a school at the mobile school where we were because of that pressure that we had from those parents, from the community. We are a school in Danun, in the heart of Danun, a very beautiful school. You will not believe when you ride in Danun that you're going to see such a beautiful school. It's a Facebook school. When the school was handed over last year in June, I could not believe it because we waited too long for that school. So now we are in that brand new school. So when we met in that in 2013, we were in that mobile school. It was very cold in winter, very hot in summertime. We had one computer that we got from the department because we could not have our computers in the lab because of the storage space. We asked Sunningdale Primary to keep those computers for us. So they were there. So it was very difficult to operate because we had to have one computer which the secretary used. Then when they came, they said the first thing they're going to do is to have two computers so that we can have connectivity. And then we had two computers, and from there they took us to the factory where we met their management, we met the staff, and I could not believe the energy that I saw there. And I said, if you can have the energy that I see in this factory, in my school, I'll be very happy. But today I'm talking a different language because the energy that I saw there is in my school. The first thing that we did was to identify projects as a staff. Reading project was one of the projects. LALT, language of learning and teaching in the classes, was another project. Arts and culture was another project. Supporting learners with learning challenges was another project. Today I've got people who are involved in the reading project in my school. Moms who volunteered. So I won't get into detail as to how that project operates because they are here to tell us as to how they're operating in my school. I've got also here Beyond, which is operating in my school in the computer lab in the afternoons. That project involves 100 learners from grade 1 to grade 4. Learners, they are using a computer, are learning math skills, are enriched in mathematics and languages. I'm hoping the ladies will be able to touch on that as well. I don't want to say it myself. Regarding the LALT, I've got one class in grade R, which is teaching in English. The other classes are teaching isiXhosa as a language of learning and teaching from grade 1 to grade 3. So what we are doing, we're piloting one English class in grade R this year. And then next day, that class is going to move to grade 1. They will be taught in English up to grade 3. We are trying to prepare them for grade 6, for intermediate and senior phase, actually, because from grade 4, they are taught in English. We found that it is difficult to handle in the intermediate and senior phase, because those learners, when they get to grade 4, firstly, they are exposed to 9 subjects, whereas they were learning 4 subjects in the foundation phase. They also had one teacher in grade foundation phase. Now they have got around 4 or 5 teachers teaching in that grade. You can imagine the transition and the confusion that goes into the minds of those learners. So we are trying to prepare them for that, for the intermediate and senior phase. For arts and culture, we have our learners were given books from Elkanah, donation of books for grade 4 written books, and then they were also invited to a workshop for arts and culture in the drama. The only project that we have not done much is the project on learners with learning disabilities that we have not touched at this stage. So the next slide, slide number one. The slide number one is about workshops that I attended and the teachers that we attended. I attended quite a number of workshops that includes call meetings and the workshops that we had. From these workshops, I learned that you need to listen to people more and don't rush. And if you listen to them more, it gives you time to think and come with a better solution. I also learned that at times you need to invite people and not force people. We have been exposed to a system in education where you are forcing your staff to do things. If they don't do it, you call them for progressive meeting. So this session has given me an option that at times I need not force the staff to do things even if they don't want. I need to invite them. As we speak now, we have a learner who is at Bloemfontein Grand High School, was doing grade 7 last year, and that learner was struggling to get fees to be at high school, but Rocks and the and businesses and their businesses funded that learner. That learner is at Bloemfontein High, doing very well there. We had a donation of a jungle gym and a trampoline for grade R. Imagine a township child seeing a trampoline for the first time. It was hard to stop other grades to use the trampoline because everyone wanted to play in that trampoline. We have the donation of computers from what is the name of the company again? From Neil Muller. At that time, we were still in the mobile school. We had those 4 computers and a laptop. That laptop helped me a lot because I come from very old school where we didn't know how even to type. But because of the emails that I have to read every day and send, I had to learn. Today I'm able to send emails. We've just had a library assistant who's assisting in the library in the afternoon. He comes at 10:30. He assists the library teacher, and then in the afternoon he's helping with the reading, the parents in the afternoon. Our staff has changed. We are at the beginning. They thought, "What is going on here? What is this principal doing? Is he up to a tender or something?" And I told Erin that Erin is not going to be easy because these people are thinking maybe I'm going to be a rich man now. But now they believe that this thing is genuine, it's for the benefit of the school. And I'm also happy that the department also supported us because we had to consult them with the reading project because it was clashing with our tuition time. I must say, we are very happy. We are still continuing. The plan was to, the aim was to be a partnership for a year, but we are continuing. As I said, we have got projects that are running. Thank you so much.
I'm not going to do too long intro. Kelly and Louise represent a group of moms that crossed our path at a time that we just came about with the 4 strategic objectives. Up until then, we were doing all sorts of bits and pieces, and literacy was the first thing that we wanted to tackle, and then they came across our path. I'm just going to let them tell the story from there onwards.
Okay. Right. Hello, everybody. I'm Kelly from the Books and Beyond team, and this is Tracy. Sure. I heard about PFP, really loved the idea, and wanted to get involved. But the idea of being a business partner didn't quite resonate with me. So I met with Louise, we did some brainstorming, and she put me in contact with Erinne. Looking back, I had no idea what a remarkable journey we were about to embark on. I persuaded three dear friends to join me in meeting Erinne and Sabella to hear all about Sopa Karma. I think what struck us most at this point was just the awesome relationship of trust that Sabella and Erinne had developed, which just made the school an opening, welcome place, and we slotted right into that. Sabella and Erinne had also spent time with the management team, as he mentioned, defining the strategic goals, and as mentioned, literacy was one of them. So, sure, all of us being book lovers, being the members of the same book club, immediately put up our hands and went, literacy, right, we can do this, we want to be involved. And the Books and Beyond team was born. And thanks to Erinne for our little logo. At this point, we spent some time doing some research on how to go forward with literacy. We received great support and encouragement and a lot of advice from the Western Cape Education Department, from Alkana, the School of Creative Learning, from Nali Bali, and from Shine. So eventually we were ready to do something with literacy. The first thing we did was to encourage reading for fun in both Khoza and English. We partnered with Nali Bali, who provided the Sunday Times Express on a weekly basis. And the Nali Bali stories, I don't know if anybody knows them, but they're these awesome stories in Khoza and English. And you can actually take the newspaper and fold and cut to make them into little books. These books have been used by the teachers extensively in their classrooms, and the stories thoroughly enjoyed by the learners and teachers alike. Our second initiative was to implement an English literacy program where we would follow a more formal methodology, very similar to Shine's methodology, and we would give individual attention to learners. So we implemented this program in April 2015 with great support from Sabella and his teachers. I'm going to leave Tracy to share a little bit of that magical journey with the children with you. Okay, so this really brings me to the point of implementation. Can we change the slide? Right, so we actually became involved at this point with far more with the school, and we quickly realized that implementation resources, including project management skills, were needed if we were going to develop the principles of PFP at Sopa Karma. Okay, now the next one. So based on that, ROGS Academy NGO was born, and this NGO was set up. Now, please bear with me here, because goals are always a bit long-winded, so if you could just bear with me. And our goal here was to achieve real sustainable change, create a well-performing school with committed staff and an environment of continuous learning for the children. To achieve this goal, as well as the school strategic goal, Books and Beyond and Sopa Karma worked together to implement a number of appropriate programs. And, of course, you have to have measurement, someone mentioned earlier on, and we'll be working, like to work closely with the WCED to achieve these measures. All right. Okay, I know this is a very, very busy slide, and I'm sure a lot of you can't see it, but what it really represents is the ROGS Academy Books and Beyond strategic plan for Sopa Karma. On the left-hand side, we've got the plan, which I've kind of told you all about, and in the middle, we've got all our programs, and on the right-hand side, all our partners. We spent a long time meeting with different peoples and different players and to get those connected partners. It's amazing how many people want to plug in, and it's been a great journey. So with regards to the programs, I could sit here and talk to you all night about some of the wonderful programs we've put in at Sopa Karma, but unfortunately I'm limited to time, so I'll just quickly give you an overview. So we've implemented literacy and numeracy programs. We've already spoken about the literacy side of it, and we'll be implementing a numeracy program. in the after-school space. So Bello mentioned that we've put in the Year Beyond program. This is a program which is offered by the Premier Office to 100 school children in the afternoons, where they learn numeracy and literacy online and face-to-face. What's very interesting about this program is that they also provide the opportunity to 5 young volunteers who help the learners. Sure, it's been interesting working with 20-year-olds again. Thoroughly enjoyed it. And we have some real talent coming up in this country. Okay, the next one is really our catch-up programs. Sorry, let me just find my notes there. Okay, then catch-up program. We found that a lot of the grade, when the children get to grade 1, a lot of them haven't completed grade R. So in the early part of 2017, we'll be implementing a catch-up program using a product called Brain Boosters, which is CAPS-aligned. So we look forward to doing that. Food, sure. As we know, children can't learn on an empty stomach. So we facilitated and got involved with existing feeding schemes to make sure that the food is delivered. We've also connected an organization, Mothers That Care, who come in and make sandwiches for the children of Sapakama. The library, we provided support to Noxie, where is Sabella, who has really spent the time getting the library operational and up and running. This library is beautiful, and we are so proud of it because it's going to provide a wonderful space for the children of Sapakama. In terms of the computer lab, sure, a lot of the infrastructure was there, but we did help and support in getting their Wi-Fi connected, and an IT resource has been provided to the school through the Yearboard program. Sure, this is a very exciting program that we've just started. We've partnered with Quantum Growth, who have offered the opportunity to all the teachers of Sapakama for self and team development using a product called Lumina Learning. And we're very excited about that. Okay, so that's really what we've done to date. And for 2017, we still have great plans. As I said, when I joined, I had no idea what a journey it was going to be. I thought it would be a quick year in and out. And now we have all these great plans for 2017. The main thing in 2017 is we would like to assist with providing the teachers with more resources and training, hopefully with the help of all our academic partners. As Sabella mentioned, there's 1,500 children in Sapakama, and we would like them all to receive opportunities. And at the end of the day, the teachers are the ones that are going to make a difference to the children of South Africa. We'd also like to focus on further relationship building with the SGB and key stakeholders, assist with programs for remedial intervention, address LALT, the language of learning and choice, inclusion of the parents and local community, and basically any other opportunity that comes our way, we'll do it. Okay, and then just very quickly, just to mention, I have mentioned a lot of them already, but just our partners that we formed are really the Western Cape Education Department, the school governing body, the Western Cape government, obviously Partners for Possibility, academic partners, Nali Bali, Number Sense, we have on board Brain Boosters, Click, Green Shoots, Shine. Others are really our volunteers who we rely a lot on, and Tracy will share some more of that with you. Elkana, the School of Creative Learning, Mothers That Care, The Bookery, Quantum Growth, Boost Africa, and SALT. Thank you very much. That's my time up. I'll hand over to Tracy.
I'm Tracy. I'm just going to give you a little brief outline of making our literacy program appeared to be real, and we're relating it to real people. We've recently completed our first year of the literacy program at the school. It's awesome to think that we started with 9 volunteers and 19 children sitting outside in the quad at the temporary school premises, and we are now almost 22 volunteers, including backups, with 34 children and currently growing. We work with grade 2 and 3 children twice a week for an hour at a time, following the SHINE methodology. And just in line with what Sabella said about the language transfer in grade 4, that's the reason why we work with them from mid-June grade 2 until mid-June grade 3. The program has attracted a diverse range of volunteers, from older retired people to moms with children. During the regular time that we spend with the children, we develop close relationships with them. The volunteers and the children love these sessions. In fact, when a volunteer is absent for some reason, often they will follow up on the session and check how did their children do today. It's hard not to be affected by the enthusiasm of the children and their willingness to learn. And it's heartwarming when you arrive at the school and the children rush up and give you hugs and high fives, or you start a reading session and they want to read a special story or play their favorite game. I started working with a little boy called Iletu. He's the one next to me in the middle. I could see from the first off that he was a bright boy, eager to learn. But even over the year that we spent with him, I saw improvement. During the course of the year, we had a reshuffle of volunteers, and he moved into a group with another volunteer called Louise. And she said she asked him in her first session with him, "How did you learn to speak such good English?" So he said, he answered, "Tracy." And really, there's nothing more rewarding than to spend one's time doing something that is so worthwhile. The experience has even inspired some of our volunteers to learn basic causa so that they can facilitate their sessions with the learners better. At the end of the last term, we had a graduation ceremony for the children as they'd completed a year's program with us. Teachers, parents, volunteers, children, representatives from the WCED all attended, and it was a very special occasion. Sabelo gave the most motivating speech. He's not here to take the credit now. And each of the children was rewarded with a book, a prize, and a certificate from their volunteer. We also need to acknowledge the support and involvement of particularly the grade 2 and 3 teachers at Sopakama in this process. Callie's mentioned Noxie at the library. She's now in charge of the literacy program at the school. And before that, we had a wonderful support in Beauty, who's now moved schools. Of course, it was sad to say goodbye to those children after their first year, but we were excited to welcome the new group. We started with them in July. And these emotional rewards are the reasons why our volunteers are drawn to the program and why they remain committed to making a difference. We saw Iletu in the first slide. This is an example of the kinds of connections that are made between the volunteers and the children. This, to Louise, brought tears to her eyes on the day she received that. And then we chose Iletu to read something at the graduation ceremony. So here he is reading very confidently on stage. The next one is a picture of Iletu with his proud granny. It's not his mom. This is the parents and their children with holding their books and certificates, and the volunteers with their learners, and our Sabelo and our supporters at the WCED. Thanks.
Responsibility, just to put a little bit of context to the partnership between Sabelo and Partners for Possibilities. Now, I just started by saying that creating a better world requires teamwork and partnerships and a collaboration. And we're seeing that within Sabelo's school. There's a slide earlier in the presentation of the prefab mobile units that were placed at the school, where the school was originally housed. And then once we finished the building of the new school, they moved in June of last year. And as they moved out, the almost 1,500 learners, the next 1,300 new learners moved into the school, and suddenly we had another new school in Dunoon called Silver Leaf.
Sure.
Now, tonight is a very, very dangerous night for me, because tomorrow morning we move the learners out of the mobile units at Dunoon Primary into the new building of Dunoon. So I'm sincerely hoping that by tomorrow afternoon I do not have a fifth school in the noon, Sabelo. So it's a huge challenge.
Sure.
I think the essence of the Partnership for Possibility is extending the reach into our schools and working with our principals and our managers at our institutions. And the value of that, we've heard very clearly from two or three of the principals that spoke here earlier.
As a department, we encourage business to get involved with all our schools. We don't want to become the dumping ground for the old computers that we do not have space for at our offices anymore. We are not looking for that type of handout in our schools anymore. We're looking for hand-ups in our schools where managers within organizations come into our schools to support our principals and the management teams of our schools to become more effective in delivering a better service to our communities. So I'm very keen on the project within our district, and I support it completely because the benefits are very clearly visible at the school. I've had the pleasure of visiting Dunoon and Sopokama very recently, and it wasn't a very good message that I went to the principal with, because we've had threats of community uprising and burning of mobile units and things. I went and I spoke to Sabelo and his management team, and when you come in and the management team says, Mr. Mayor, that will definitely not happen in our area. We will definitely stop any person from wanting to cause any damage to any learning institution within our area. Then it says to me that somewhere the boxes have not only just been ticked, but significant value has been added in terms of an understanding and an appreciation of the opportunity to provide our learners with an opportunity to learn. And I'm encouraged by that. And I think this type of project needs to be increased significantly over the next few years. I sincerely hope that we move way beyond the 2,000 target that you've set yourself. And do understand, when I speak here, I do not speak of Metro North District alone, because even myself, I'm literally on an exposure within a district. I'm actually an HR person in the head office, but I've been tasked to be working in the district for the next 9 months until December, until we've appointed a new person there. But the experience and the understanding that it has given to me as to what's happening at the schools, at the coalface, where principal has to deal with a learner that has been shot, and at the same time we're standing and shouting, the curriculum must be delivered, and the assessment must be done in a particular way, and we lose sight of all the other contextual issues that are happening at our schools. And so it's these types of partnerships that empowers our managers at our schools to ensure that our learners get the best opportunity. I'm encouraged by it, Louise, I honestly am, and I sincerely hope that we surpass the target of 2,000. Metro North is there and it will support you in what you do. But so my colleagues in all the other districts, whether it's Winelands, Mr. Benjamin out there, or Mr. Glenn Van Harte out in South, we need to speak to them, and I will definitely share with them the kind of advantages that we've received from these partnerships. I want to conclude, you know, this is a very difficult time for the year for most parents, because now the acceptance for grade 1 and for grade 8 letters have been sent out. And so the responses I get from some of the corporates, you know, the one with the beautiful advert that talks about South Africa and the foreign, the Japanese lady saying, load shedding, you know, you remember that company. one of their senior executives writes to me on a particular day and says, do your principals not understand what it means to manage an institution? And I said, oh, thank you very much. I sincerely hope you understand what actually happens in a school. And I actually want to invite him to become a partner for Possibility. So that he can come and understand what actually happens in the school and have a greater appreciation of the work that our teachers and our principals do in our school. It's not an easy task. It's not an easy task. And so the invitation is open to many other corporates to come in and get involved. I'd like Nedbank to become involved. I was a client of theirs many years ago. And the time one spends on the call waiting for their service sometimes, you know, was not a good experience. Perhaps we could talk to them while we have them in a corner. So the Western Cape Education Department will support these types of initiatives. It makes our task easier. It gives us a much more empowered core of educators and principals within our school. And I look forward to the new challenges that you are going to bring to our principals to make them stronger, to deliver better for the children of our country. Thank you.
Thank you, Ellen. I'm well aware of the time of the fact that we're running out of time. Ooh, time is up. So I'm going to just squeeze everything I want to say really fast. But I want to give you just a little bit of a perspective from those are the prefabs, and that's the beautiful new school. Let's roll from here. I think from my point of view, I just want to give the people in the room here that come from a business environment a bit of a background. Now, Rogs happens to be a 21-year-old company. Like many other companies, after a period, you start thinking of bigger things than just having a financial agenda. And it was a big thing for our company that we wanted to have, to use our business as a vehicle to do some change, or to bring about some change. And education was one of the obvious causes. As Louise said, I got carried away a bit, but that's a very long story, and it's actually quite ridiculous. But then I stumbled upon PFP, which was a bit of a mercy, because at that stage I'd already gone out large and saying, I'm going to do this. And when PFP crossed my path, it was a very good fit. And although we laugh about it today, the point is PFP has got a structure that it provided me to fit into. It's got a course materials, support, experience. It gave me a platform from where I could get involved. But on the other hand, the second aspect of the PFP program that I really enjoy is that it also allowed me enough freedom to implement my own way. So if you listen to Andy's story, we've got nothing like it. And if you look at Ridwan's story, we've got nothing. We haven't done a Mandela Day yet properly, and I don't know whether Sabella can cook. Can you? So the point is, we've made a completely different plan. We were allowed to implement the resources that we had available. So I'm going to do a quick few little slides, but that's an important part for everybody to understand here. There is structure and there's freedom, and it allows you a lot of ability to deal with issues relevant at that school, because every school is different, every principal is different, every support structure is different, and you've got to use those strengths rather than trying a cookie-cutter approach. So just to fill you in, we're based in Montague Gardens, so Pakama was a good choice for us because a lot of our factory workers reside in the Noon area, and a number of their children are at Pakama. And at this point, I just want to kind of indicate that in our case, we immediately realized that ROGS as a company, ROGS Academy that we start as an NGO, cannot do everything that we want to do. But what we can do is we can harness momentum amongst our community. So one of the early learnings that we found out is we spoke about the four strategic objectives. That took us 6 to 7 months to just get that far. The first thing is I had to get to know Sabella. I arrived there from a business environment with a little bit of a cowboy attitude and just wanted to march in and say, how quick can we get going? And I had the similar rude awakening that Witta had when you arrived there. It's like, whoa, okay, maybe I should stop, slow down, and listen first get to know the man, and then get to know the environment a little bit, and it took a lot of ear time rather than air time from my side to just get familiarized myself. And there's another learning that I want to pass on, is although we had strategic objectives, without those we wouldn't really have long-term impact. We also had to have a two-pronged approach where we embrace all opportunities that came our way in those early days. I tell many people that when the Jungle Gym was offered by friends, I kind of looked, no, come on, guys. We want to change education. You give me a Jungle Gym? For crying out loud, I mean, really? But for 6 months, we feasted off the Jungle Gym. The August was there. We were on ETV and everywhere. It's like, oh, we have a Jungle Gym. But that brought more people. That's the point. So you had to take all the opportunities you did, the low-hanging fruit, and we did bits while we got to know each other better and while we earned the trust from the staff to know that Sabella wasn't getting backhanders from me, and then we could actually deal with the strategic objectives that we defined together. So that's a long story. It must be way over time. But one of our, to talk about the support group that we've built, one of our key support groups is Alkana School, which is a private school there. It could be anything for anyone else. In our case, we've got SALT, who is a social outreach program that's linked to that church. They become a partner at a school next door. We've certainly, in our case, involved our customers. The Swiss customer over there has actually sponsored the partnership for Dunoon Primary. The American customers love the choir, so they donated shoes. The Israeli customer loved the vegetable garden. So whatever is in your resource pool, you can apply. It will not be the same. There's the Simbulele, who's now in the second year of scholarship, and this was funded by a customer overseas again. So we put the news out there, and different people participate in different ways. And then obviously we use the people in our business to go there from time to time, build relationship, and do what we can do. So I'm not going to have a long list of thank yous here tonight. I think Kelly did a good job of listing many people, but I do want to thank specifically the ladies from Books and Beyond. Kelly and Tracy were up here, but there's also Amy that's in the room here, and Louise is not here tonight, but they've done a phenomenal job. And I do want to thank Sabello. He's been key to this, key to making it happen. I know there's a lot of principals and teachers in the room tonight. I want you to know that I'm of the opinion that you hold our future in your hands, so I have the greatest respect for what you guys do. I certainly thought I had a tough job as a business until I got there. And Louise has asked me to give a little bit of a sentiment of what the learnings are from a business point of view. I can assure you that we've seen transformation at our company. Similar to what was mentioned here before, I went there partly to go and see what I can do, but our company was transformed. Our staff realized that we've got greater values. Our customers have been drawn to this, as I've mentioned, and similarly with our suppliers. From a personal point of view, leadership-wise, when I go into Dunoon, I've got no title, I've got no authority, I've got no mandate. I've had to learn to work with a different sort of influence. I've had to look at the possibilities there. It is not a fix-it program, so I can't just immediately focus on the problems, but I've learned to look at the possibilities. If you listen to the choir just now, you'll see one of the great possibilities. So there's been a lot of learnings there. And before I let you go, because I know I can always squeeze a minute, I have one question. I'm going to leave you with a question here tonight. After listening to this, do you think that we can make a difference? And I'm not talking about the people that are in government department. I'm not talking to the civilians here, civil society and business. Because I do think we can. Yeah. I believe in the fact that many times a little equals a lot. Mm. Yeah. And we only have 20,000 schools to go, and we've got 500 already. And that started from one not too many years ago. Yeah. I believe that civil society and business can do a lot. So I'm going to do what teachers do. I'm going to ask you all, and that's completely uncool. Can all of you quickly stand up? I'm going to milk this night. Okay, so roughly here is where I see the halfway line. So can everybody in the right-hand side of the classroom sit down? And you must stand. So, round about here, Gerrit, you must sit still, and then round about there. A few more must sit. Few more. Okay. Tani moet ook sit, asseblief. Okay, that's it. So that to me looks roughly 50%. So picture this. Every year in South Africa, we send roughly this room multiplied by thousands into our education system. This group here never makes it to matric. This group does. And we're not even talking about a great pass in matric or tertiary education. Then it'll be a very thin slither here. What do you guys feel like when you look at them? You didn't even have the opportunity. Okay, we can all sit down now. But the point is, that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing every year. I mean, we can't continue doing that. And I mean, everybody, they are, as we've seen, there's a lot of people working on this. But my question is that you need to find a way of getting involved. I do believe we can. I do believe we have a choice whether you want to participate or spectate. Thank you very much. Sorry.
Thank you.
Way over time.
Thank you.
Yeah.